listening to WMNHLP, Manchester's radio, broadcasting at 95.3 megahertz frequency modulation from the top of 1000 Elm Street. Our studios are located at 1045 Elm Street and licensed to Manchester Public Television Service in Manchester, New Hampshire, USA. Contact us by email at WMNH953@gmail.com or through our website at WMNHradio.org.
Congress rejected a bill to approve more disaster aid for Puerto Rico. President Trump appeared to express frustration with the aid the islands already received. President Trump tweeted, "Puerto Rico got $91 billion for the hurricane, more money than has ever been gotten for a hurricane before." Those are hard numbers, and we can check them. And the president is wrong on both accounts. To jog your memory, Hurricane Maria pummeled Puerto Rico in September 2017. It took almost 11 months to restore power across the island, and the latest death toll from the nearly Category 5 storm is around 3,000. FEMA tracks active disaster relief spending online. As of December 31st, 2018, Congress had approved over $40.7 billion for Puerto Rico. But only about $11.2 billion of that has actually been spent. A senior administration official told our partners at PolitiFact the president's $91 billion number included $50 billion in anticipated spending. So he didn't pull the number out of thin air. But it is inaccurate and misleading to lump hypothetical future spending in with congressionally approved spending. The other half of the president's tweet said Puerto Rico received a record amount of money. The numbers don't support that claim either. It's hard to compare the recovery costs for different storms since the circumstances vary, but let's look at Hurricane Katrina and Hurricane Maria. Katrina devastated New Orleans in 2005, but the Gulf Coast region was also impacted by other systems like Hurricanes Wilma and Rita. Puerto Rico was in a similar situation in 2017. The island took a direct hit from Maria, but the damage was compounded by other hurricanes that passed close by, like Hurricane Irma. Now let's look at the costs. In August 2007, the Congressional Budget Office said Congress had approved $94.8 billion for the Gulf Coast. Total spending for Katrina recovery has gone up since 2007, but that time frame makes for a good point of comparison to the current situation in Puerto Rico. Congressionally approved spending currently sits at about $40.7 billion. That's not anywhere near $94.8 billion earmarked for the 2005 hurricanes in the 2 years after those storms. That makes President Trump's record claim false. Before we even consider more up-to-date Katrina recovery costs. This story is reported in partnership with PolitiFact. It's part of a...
Every American should be outraged by the situation. The whole thing is embarrassing and ultra, ultra disturbing.
Good morning. This is a Juice News call-out. In the wake of Cablegate and the subsequent fallout, balls out revelations, observations of diplomats, giving actual confirmation of hidden facts, spilling backroom deals, leaking leaders' chit-chat, money laundering and tit-for-tat, spits and spats. The picture that emerges, provided by the service, shines like further behind the wire curtain. Certainly, this has divided views of the populace. Some say it's obvious, nothing new in these documents. Others say it's ominous and applaud the revelations. Others still call for the messenger's assassination. Following Assange's arrest and calls for his head, over 9,000 counterattacks on all of the web. The State Department being forced to defend, spying at the UN and a secret war in Yemen. Despite DDoS attacks on WikiLeaks system, day by day cables still spray through mirror reflection. Will Cablegate change the game or lead to repression? We get face to face with Hillary Clinton. Hillary Clinton, how does it feel to get leaked on?
It's scandalous. This is a case of high treason. It's against the land of the brave and divine freedom. We're the good guys for democracy. We fight evil, and we've waged peace around the world, proud of the flag. These leaks could devalue this powerful brand, bring military operations straight to a halt. Our shareholders, clients, and partners would plainly revolt.
But aren't you beholden to the American public? And isn't the U.S. one of the primary culprits in overthrowing governments?
Such as?
Chile, Iran, Nicaragua?
Please, stop with the drama. The American people are are our employees, whose taxes fund the wars that support our schemes. Their kids become troops we send overseas in return for mega malls and the American dream. And if our client states don't like the things that we do, we install a dictator with a CIA coup. In foreign relations, subversion is the method we use. WikiLeaks threaten the system, so it's a terrorist group.
But people of the world seem to generally approve of WikiLeaks' actions in spreading the truth.
They do? Well, then they're terrorists too. Dissenters are traitors, as history proves, and they always lose.
That's curious. Weren't some of our greatest heroes persecuted for this reason?
Who?
Mandela, Gandhi, Jesus? You idealists. Okay, now for another perspective. Prison Planet host Alex Jones.
She will be the megaphone.
This Assange has apparently shown the emperor on the palace throne grew evident clothes. But I've heard anecdotes, I'll show it fits. This Patsy's a triple agent for the globalists. He claims openness, but he's actually a catalyst for the one world government of commie Nazi fascists. Robert, I'm getting paranoid. I need to state this is a false flag attack to bring in a police state. A cyber 9/11, that's the secret vision. Right now they're debriefing Julian in a British prison.
So WikiLeaks is an inside job?
They hide the truth to distract from the climate deal in Cancun.
You tried doing my job without hiding something. I ain't called Secretary of State for nothing.
But surely, now you're exposed out on the stage, one would expect the world's leaders to be outraged by the spying, lies, emerging charges. Now on the line, it's Colonel Gaddafi.
Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum assalam. Are you outraged?
Well, now that there's a Muslim, brother president of US, we expected secrets to be kept. Now we have to keep abreast of these huge security leaks. Obama must get firm grip on WikiTits.
How about you, Mr. Berlusconi? Will your reputation fall more in this pandemonium?
Maravetto. Gli italiani mi amano come bambini. E li lo metto in culo come Mussolini. The American flag is symbol global of liberty. And I love Hillary, though she's a bit too old for me. By the way, Robert, how much for your new show? I pay cash. I just got some rubles.
Sorry, Silvio, we have scruples. It's not for sale.
Bravo. Hillary, come have a cigar at my hotel.
Well, Hillary, it appears that the leaders are not that outraged.
Are you serious? Of course not. We're one happy family tree, son, as you'll see soon when we hang Assange for treason.
Treason? Could an Australian ever stand trial?
Ha! Australia's in the American Empire. We have puppet states, franchisees, subsidiaries. Provided they obey, they're guaranteed liberty. We're not letting Assange get out of our grip. You know how hard it was to plant a condom that splits?
Hell, you turd! Your Bilderberg lies are blatant!
But Alex, where's your evidence that Assange is an agent?
Well, obviously, this is a globalist psyops plot designed to keep us in the dark. They're climbing in your windows, they're snatching your income tax, trying to sleep you so you'll need to hide your keys, hide your wife, buy a gun, buy a knife, watch my show, buy your gold, and buy your silver, because they're sleeping everybody out here. We don't have to look for no facts, we know this is true. They gon' chip you, they gon' tag you, but we can run and yell that, run and yell that, run and yell that.
We got his ID, he done left out a dissent. Oh, he is so done, he is really going on trial. But what is Assange accused of?
I was molested by Julian in the Stockholm.
So done, so done, so done, so.
Okay, it's almost time to end for the day. But until we meet again, a few questions remain. Is WikiLeaks really the greatest threat that we face? Or is it the response we're seeing in defense of the state? A response which is building and seeks to turn back the clock on freedom of speech and fundamental rights earned over a century. This should ring alarm bells for all who know their history. From this evidence, are we neglecting our memory and repeating the trajectory of the 20th century? And if so, upon seeing the facts but ceasing to act, don't we deserve the leaders we have? What needs to befall before we open the door and yell,
I'm mad as hell, I'm not gonna take it anymore?
Or do we sit waiting for messiahs or aliens or a superhero if they're not all one in the same meme? History, dear viewers, is happening. Will we ever get a similar chance again? History books will be written about events this month. The story they will tell is up to us.
Where is Matt Connerton? I want Matt Connerton back. I know nothing about WikiLeaks. It's not my thing. And I know there is something having to do with Julian Assange. I've been seeing what's happened with Assange, and that will be a determination, I would imagine, mostly by the Attorney General, who's doing an excellent job. So he'll be making a determination. I know nothing really about him. It's not my deal in life.
What would you like
WikiLeaks?
I don't really have any opinion. I know the Attorney General will be involved in that, and he'll make a decision. Okay?
WikiLeaks. I love WikiLeaks.
These WikiLeaks, as confirmed just today by WikiLeaks.
It's been amazing what's coming out on WikiLeaks. They want to distract us from WikiLeaks.
The wonder of WikiLeaks.
Boy, that WikiLeaks has done a job on her, hasn't it?
We've learned so much from WikiLeaks.
Oh, we love WikiLeaks. Boy, they have really WikiLeaks.
WikiLeaks.
WikiLeaks. I mean, this WikiLeaks is fascinating.
The WikiLeaks revelations. This WikiLeaks is like a treasure trove.
WikiLeaks.
WikiLeaks, right?
WikiLeaks.
And you know, as I was getting off the plane, they were just announcing new WikiLeaks, and I wanted to stay there, but I didn't want to keep you waiting.
I love reading those WikiLeaks.
It's WikiLeaks. WikiLeaks.
Hey everybody, welcome. It's that time again. Matt Connerton unleashed in the afternoon. We are live on WMNH 95.3 FM, emanating from downtown Manchester, New Hampshire. Of course, also on Comcast 97 in Manchester, streaming worldwide at WMNHradio.org, and of course on Facebook via Facebook Live on the Matt Connerton Unleashed Facebook page. Jenny is here as well.
Happy anniversary.
Yes.
Happy anniversary.
It is the, and look, there's even a balloons that someone very thoughtfully left for us here.
Oh, yes,
in
that's
the, in
true.
The studio.
Yes. I hadn't noticed that they were there.
The 2-year anniversary, I believe it's today, April 11th, of
you're old, dude.
Matt Connerton Unleashed on WMNH 95.3 FM. So very, very exciting.
Is Facebook working today?
Deserves an air horn. What do you mean?
I don't know. I can't find it. I literally can't find you. You've disappeared from me.
That's weird. You're hiding
on me, aren't you?
There's
this
people,
is all about yesterday. You want Ridley.
There's people in the Facebook live chat. Ed Murphy is in there as well as Christian Cunard.
Oh, so you're like just blocking me out then.
I don't know. I don't know why you can't get into it. Oh, we have a call. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this?
This is Easy G.
Easy G. Now, I hope this is Easy G and not the ghost of Easy G, because we've been very concerned about your health.
Yeah, I know. I got my feet elevated right now. And, boy, I don't have all the test results. I probably won't get it until tomorrow, but I'm thinking that I have cellulitis again for the third time.
Oh. I'm so sorry.
Easy
G. My legs are swelled up and both my feet are swelled up. I know women can get swelled feet when they're pregnant, but as far as I know, I'm not pregnant and I'm not a woman. So.
Hey, don't be so sure. I don't think I've shared this on the air, but I recently had some x-rays done because I was curious. Turns out I do indeed have fallopian tubes. Who knew? So anything is possible, Easy G.
Yeah,
anything is possible.
Boy.
Now,
oh boy.
I do know, I don't know what those medical people are telling you, but I have a great idea for what I think would cure what ails you and would help you to feel a lot better. You know what that is?
I have no idea.
Some smooth jazz.
Oh, I knew you were going to bring that.
Ah, you should just put on some John Tesh and enjoy the healing.
All my crazy fans, I will not be at the morning show tomorrow. So I was told by the doctor to do as much resting as I can in the next 4 days. I mean, I got to get better. I got to be on antibiotics 3 times a day and And I know the drill. So I've done this before, so here we go again. You know.
What will you be doing in terms of?
But it certainly seems like it's cellulitis. I'll know more tomorrow, probably, when I get the results.
I'm just glad you went to the doctor.
I get blood work at the doctor
today.
So I was there for a couple hours, unfortunately. But
have you been in touch?
The Gonzo there. He brought me to the doctor, so that was really nice of him. So
have you been in touch with your publicist? Is there a statement being prepared?
Yeah, I'm making the statement. So.
Oh, you're making a statement right here, live on Matt Connerton Unleashed. It's like the exclusive ECG statement about tomorrow. This is fantastic.
I'm still alive. I know Peter had a rough night there. I thought he was dying, but
Peter thought he was dying.
I was a little horrified with all of my bad legs and feet. But
Peter thought
I'm gonna bounce back and I'll be better, but I'm gonna have to rest the next couple of days. So.
Did Peter think he had cellulitis? Is that what it's called?
I don't know 100%, but I know the symptoms. I've had it before. I could barely put my shoes on this morning, so I said, "Oh great, I'm probably get cellulitis again."
You said Peter thought he was dying last night.
Yeah, well, he had a problem, but he seemed to bounce back pretty good, you know. So.
Well, you know what? He probably did to bounce back
healthy,
from it.
You know, healthier than me. I always seem to have these nagging health issues.
You know what? I think he probably did. He probably laid back and put on some smooth jazz.
Yeah, well, I gotta wear those stockings again. Those compressive stockings.
I'm
working again on Monday, so hopefully, God willing, I'll be back to the cream lane on Monday. So.
Wear those while listening to some Kenny G. You'll feel great.
Yeah.
you sound skeptical.
Well, anyway,
Eric.
So you guys have a good show. I'll be listening to the rest of the show, and like I said to all my fans, I'll hopefully be back on Monday. So I gotta rest my feet. So otherwise, I'm gonna be off. If I don't rest in this weekend, I'll be out all next week, and I don't want to do that because. I don't have any of these jobs I have. There's no benefits. So if I don't show up, I don't get paid. So.
Right. Yes. Well, EZG,
that's
please.
That's the fun of having part-time jobs. They're good jobs, but.
Right. Please.
No side benefits. So not like the old Stop and Shop days where I had accumulated some sick time and personal days and none of that.
No. Why don't you work there anymore? What happened? Oh, they closed, didn't they? Did you?
Yeah, they closed. Yeah.
So you didn't get fired.
I no longer working there.
You didn't get fired from there. They closed. You were downsized.
Plus, Market Basket
so to speak.
Had a lot to do with that too. You know, the prices were a lot cheaper. So
did Market Basket fire you?
Why do
Market
you think
Basket,
he got
they put us out of business basically. So.
Oh, right. But you did you ever work at Market Basket?
No, that's one of the stores I have not worked at.
So. Oh, okay. All right. I didn't know if maybe...
believe it or not. I worked a lot of places over the years.
They didn't try to poach you
not
from Stop
that,
and Shop?
It's my history.
I can't believe it. Right, yes. You have quite the work history, Eric. I would love to see your resume.
He's a hard worker.
How many jobs have you had?
I mean, he has like two
I
now,
I've probably
right?
had about 50 over the years. So
50 jobs.
Well, yeah, but you're a little...
Hard at, but
oh,
jeez. I can't say it was anybody else's fault but my own, so...
That's right. Well, you know what? It 50 jobs deserves an air horn for one thing, but also too. I mean that's
the
kind of.
Yeah, he did the air horn today, which I was surprised.
Well, I'm glad that he did. 50 jobs. That's the kind of experience employers look for. Like, and when they look at your resume and they're like, "Oh my goodness, you've had 50 jobs."
I had to
you're
tell
hired.
You something real quick. That was a long opening today. I said, "Well, I can't wait to call
I
the show." It's like,
that
wow,
many.
That was a long opening.
Yes. That was a long opening.
All right, well, I'm gonna clear the air. I'm gonna clear the airlines if anybody wants to call. So.
All right, easy G.
We'll see you guys around. Thank you very much.
All right, take care.
Hugs, feel better.
All right, that was easy G issuing his official statement that he will not be on the morning show tomorrow.
I think you got the scoop on Peter.
I guess so. Yes. Well, you know, he had no other. So if that were EZG's ghost, it would probably sound more like this.
Oh, guys.
So that was. We're pretty sure that was in fact EZG. Unlike, of course, the ghost of John McCain, who is here with us. The ghost of John McCain, of course, the official co-host on Matt Connerton Unleashed.
I'm John McCain.
Yes.
Wise
and,
guy.
And we have virtual Dave Ridley here as well.
Yeah.
He's always here. He is omnipresent, and Jenny's here.
There he goes again.
And the rest.
You know, I'm going to go next door to the pizza place and get a nice, big, juicy pepperoni and pineapple.
Ew. Well, you enjoy that pineapple. That's
right.
is
Disgusting.
I'm going to sit down and slowly eat it right in front of you.
Oh, my goodness. We have another call. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this?
Hey, Matt. How's it going, dude?
That's going great. How's it going for you?
Awesome. Good, good.
Good, good, good.
Where's Hopwood, dude?
I haven't. Has he been in this week? Yes, yeah. No, he was. Yeah.
No, he was in one day.
He was in one day, yes, because he upset Fred Bohnig. But it is difficult when he's not here. I don't know about you, but my heart slowly breaks when I don't see him.
Yeah, dude, same.
He's on my mind.
Anyway,
you know?
I have two things. One, I have all my support for the Shop and Stop employees, and I hope that they get their goals and all that. And can I have a large pizza, please? Thank you.
All right. You got it. It's on the way. Thank you for the call.
Awesome. Thank you, dude.
All right. Bye-bye.
See, everybody wants me to go get you a pepperoni and pineapple pizza.
No,
that's
no.
What the deal is.
He was ordering a pizza. He wasn't saying for me.
No, no. I think he was trying to order for you. Why would anybody try and order from you? Of course they're going to order for you.
Yes, yes.
I mean, that's especially today of all days.
So Christian Cunard says, happy anniversary, Matt. Hey, Jenny and Matt. Rhonda Ostrowitz Favero says, congratulations on your anniversary, Matt. Thank you. She also said, John Tesh, I think I just threw up in my mouth. Well,
I'm right there with you, woman.
Don't try to blow into a saxophone after doing that if you feel like playing some smooth jazz, because you'll ruin the saxophone with your mouth vomit. Hello to Angela Philbrook in the Facebook live chat, who says, glad you are okay, Eric. I think we're all glad of that. Rhonda says, Kenny G, even worse. How dare you, Rhonda? Rhonda doesn't sound like appreciates the smooth jazz. Pete Trouble Morse is in the Facebook live chat. Christian says, that sounds pretty good. I'll take a slice, Jenny. And Pete says, I think all this fame is finally getting to Eric's head. I noticed, Pete, you capitalized the word fame, which makes me think that Eric believes that with his fame, he's going to live forever. Like the kids from Fame.
Oh, God, no.
Yeah, that was...
No, that was terrible.
I'll admit that was that was a long way to drive. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this?
Hey, this is Easy G again. I forgot to say, happy anniversary.
Oh, thank you, Easy G.
Aw, you're so sweet.
Easy G, did you see the beautiful balloons
that someone left for me?
Even
I'm not feeling the best, I should say happy anniversary.
I wish...
Happy anniversary to your show.
All right, thank you, Easy G.
I think the world of Easy G.
I wish Easy G were here. Hello to Peter White, who joins us in the Facebook live chat. Peter White, of course, host of The Morning Show with Peter White, which you can hear weekdays, 7 to 9 a.m.
Was Pete in there in enough time to hear the official Easy G release?
You mean his statement?
Correct.
Yes. I don't know.
Oh, so we got the scoop on Peter. Doesn't know what we're saying.
I assume that, that Peter White knows that Easy G will not be here tomorrow. But Peter, if you missed it, Easy G will not be on The Morning Show tomorrow. Apparently, he is resting, and he's going to be resting while listening to some smooth jazz. He wouldn't admit that that's what he's going to be doing, but I think it's fairly obvious. Pete Trouble Morse in the Facebook live chat says, wait, Eric, tell us more about your toe infection. I don't want to hear more about that. That is for certain. Peter White says, yes. I assume that means yes. He heard Easy G's statement. Actually, Peter's down a cast member, too, I noticed. I haven't noticed Len Lorenz on The Morning Show lately. I hope Len's okay. But
who in the world does he have sitting at the news desk? This mic is jacked to the ceiling.
I don't know. But
I'm not going to try and bring it back down. I'm just going to sit here like the vertically challenged person that I am.
If Peter keeps losing people, you know, he's going to need more cast members. I haven't heard Len lately. Eric's not going to be there tomorrow. Perhaps Peter will get a visit from the ghost of John McCain.
Senator Obama talks about change, but clearly he has no record of it.
Well, that ship has sailed, Senator. Let's see.
You know what it is? Is that Peter likes to actually have live people in his cast, whereas you apparently either prefer dead or electronic.
Now, we need to clarify something. Number one, as far as the ghost of John McCain, I have no control over that. He's haunting the studio, and so far he's only haunting the studio between the hours of 4 and 6 p.m. And as far as virtual Dave Ridley, I have no control over that either. He's taken over the computer like Hal from 2001. I have no...
Well,
I was trying to be nice. I was trying to be nice, but he just chimes in whenever he wants.
Is anybody buying this BS?
You're going to think it's an April Fool's joke, what I'm actually calling about. You're not going to believe it, and I didn't believe it for a while. I had to research.
See, he just butts in. So maybe Peter will get a visit from one of these folks. Who knows?
I want him fired. Tell Peter I want, yes.
Virtual Dave Ridley fired?
No, McCain. Because you
ghost of John McCain?
How dare you?
He's going to follow us home and haunt us now if you keep doing that.
Next thing I know, you're going to kick me out of the bedroom.
I'm just saying.
I have never been an astronaut, but I think I know the challenges of space.
There he goes bragging again. You see how he is, and we have a call. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this?
It's John McCain.
Wait a minute. Are you like the real John McCain? Did you just crawl out of the grave or something?
Yes.
Oh, my God.
Oh, I'm so sick.
A little dirt coming up there.
I've read about this.
Oh, God, that's awful.
I've read about this happening sometimes where someone is buried and then it turns out they're not actually dead. Or maybe that was just in a bad movie I saw. But then they have to, like, claw their way out and then they've got, like, dirt stuck in their throat or something. Is that what happened to you, Senator?
Oh, yeah, dude. Oh, it sucks. Anyway, Trump's a pussy.
Oh, my goodness. Whoa. All right. I'm going to hit the dump button on that one. I don't think we're really allowed to say the P word. Now, I mean, there was some debate over that after... a certain Access Hollywood piece of audio surfaced where Trump himself used that word, but I think that we're still not really...
Are you more of a gentleman than that,
You
Matt?
Could. Now, here's the thing, though, about that. There was a time in what we'll call the shock jock era, which I'd say was probably late 90s till maybe middle 2000s, when you... Things had gotten loose enough where you could actually get away with that particular word on FM radio. But then Janet Jackson happened and ruined everything, even though what happened with Janet Jackson at the Super Bowl had nothing to do with FM terrestrial radio.
But guy gets on stage and takes his shirt off, and nobody has a problem with that.
Who? What guy? The guy from Maroon 5?
Yeah.
Is that what he said? Oh, well, actually, a lot of people had a problem with it. A lot of people said, hey, put your shirt back on, buddy.
Yeah, we don't want to see your tatas either.
Yeah, I don't.
Men, in all seriousness now, men do have tatas.
Well, yeah.
1 in 100,000 men can actually experience breast cancer, so check your tatas there, guys.
Some of us get moobs. That's why...
You have tatas.
No.
Yes, you do. You have Yeti tatas.
I disagree.
Yes, you do.
Sometimes bodybuilders have to get the surgery. The Rock had to get the surgery. It happens with wrestlers.
What surgery?
There's a surgery because sometimes bodybuilders, wrestlers, et cetera, fighters who lift, you know, if they're bodybuilders, if they lift a lot of weights, they get, I guess they're calcium deposits that happen in the chest. So they end up with, they kind of do end up looking like they have breasts. So they have to get a surgery to fix that. And Die Hard.
Okie dokie.
Die Hard
that
wrestling.
That was information I did not know.
No, it's true. And
I really didn't.
Die Hard wrestling fans might remember. So Easy G, if you're listening, you might remember there was a brief time during the what is commonly referred to as the Attitude Era in WWE, where when The Rock was one of the top guys, where he actually wrestled with a shirt on for a couple of months, and it was because he had had the surgery. So until he healed up, he actually wrestled with a shirt. Yes.
Okay.
He would deliver the people's elbow and the Rock bottom while fully clothed.
It makes perfect sense that men can get calcium deposits regardless of bodybuilding, simply because that occurs in breast tissue and men have tatas.
Yes. Hello to Bill Muckler, who joins us in the Facebook live chat.
Bill, check your tatas.
Peter White says that Mike Doyle will be in tomorrow on the morning show. And Peter, I want you to, you know, because Mike and I really got into it yesterday, and I'm concerned that I may have been a little over the top. What I'd like you to do, Peter, if you wouldn't mind doing this for me, and if you're not comfortable with it, I completely understand. But if you could, on my behalf, because you'll see him tomorrow, if you wouldn't mind giving him a great big hug. For
a big long hug.
Yeah. For maybe about 12 to 15 seconds, just a nice warm embrace. Maybe you kind of just, rub his back a little bit and just whisper.
Bring that left hand down a little lower.
Whisper very softly into his ear. This is from Matt and he just wanted me to do this. And just kind of,
he loves you.
You know, just kind of whisper it to him. Just like I just did. And just, I just want him to know that I feel a little bit badly that I got so
worked up.
I'm starting
to feel like I should be jealous or something because you seem to be having a man bro love thing going on here.
No, I just feel terrible. And, you know, it's like the time Paul Cormier gave me a big hug, similar to that, because I'm the only one who pronounces his name correctly. And he gave me a very warm embrace. And he said,
yeah, but it wasn't 15 seconds, though. It was a little bit short.
No, it was actually, it was about 30 seconds. And for a few seconds, I was uncomfortable. And then I just kind of like went with it. But he did say to me, he said, Matt, I want you to know I appreciate you for saying you're the one person I know who actually says my name correctly. And that shows that you care and I appreciate it. And I said back to him and I said, I'm happy to do it, Paul Cormier. And thank you for this wonderful hug. And us speaking to each other in this tone doesn't in any way make it
Fred
weird.
Fred says I can live with him.
With Fred Bonig?
Yep.
Why? You want to live in Pennsylvania?
I don't know. I'd have to investigate that thought. Never really gave Pennsylvania much of a thought.
Why do you want to go live with Fred?
Well, apparently you're giving the ghost to John McCain our bedroom with you. So, I mean, there's no room for me around anymore. There's too many ghosts and electronic beings hovering about.
Trying to prevent that.
I'm very happy with where we are.
Yeah, see, so let's keep it that way. We'll keep the ghost of John McCain here.
Yeah.
I just don't want you to upset him.
Tell the truth.
And then you end up summoning him.
Okay, so truth be known. Here's a truism on Matt. He plays with him at home. He does. I hear the voice all the time.
With the voice of John McCain?
I do.
Well,
I hear him calling your name.
Well, I hear that too, but now I'm not even sure it's really him, because some dude called claiming to be the actual John McCain. So
I'm really confused. That guy, though, I think there was something fishy with that.
He sounded much younger, but is it possible that he actually is the real John McCain and this ghost is another entity? I've been warned about that. I've been warned about entities assuming friendly identities when they actually have nefarious purposes. And
that would be crazy.
Well, you can say that, ghost of John McCain, but now I'm starting to wonder if that really is you.
Because I've always had 100% absolute truth.
Okay, well, I hope so.
Yeah, I hear them, that he whispers to you all the time now. Careless whispers.
Well, that's...
Absolutely.
Rhonda says, a few maggots on your throat. Referring to John McCain who called in.
Yeah. You know, you're kind of right about that, right?
Peter White says, okay, I'll tell him you're still pissed. No, Peter, no.
Yeah, Peter, go on. Come on. Yeah, let's cause some trouble.
Here's the thing.
Let me cause some trouble because Matt's being a PIA.
I don't mind if you do that, actually, as long as you do it while engaging in a warm but heterosexual embrace.
Shirtless or with shirts?
Oh, well, boy. Well, for that part, I'm just going to say whatever you feel like.
I know what you prefer is a no shirt.
Whatever you feel like, yeah.
Because we know the Yetis love the skin-to-skin, hair-to-hair touch.
Whatever seems right in the moment, I would say, that part, yeah.
We need video. We need video. We need pictures.
Yes. Fred says,
music.
Jenny hears dead people.
Matt hears more dead people than I do.
Fred also, posted a link to a Wikipedia page about male lactation. So, well, as far as I know, I've never lactated, but as I did say earlier on the show, I did have some x-rays done and discovered that I do in fact have fallopian tubes, which is still,
do you have mammary
just,
glands too?
Stunning. No,
breast
but
milk?
No, you know, but,
or do you produce milk somewhere? We're going into Unsheathed land.
Yes, that is a discussion for Matt Connerton Unsheathed.
How many years is the anniversary for Unsheathed?
Oh, that's been on for 26 years now.
Yeah, it's awesome.
Long time.
A couple of decades.
See if you can guess where this is from.
That's easy. You don't even have to play it.
I see dead people.
Yes.
That was too easy.
Fred shared that.
Too easy, Fred. You gotta give me a harder one. That was too easy.
He sees dead people.
I could tell just by the sound. He didn't even have to say anything. Which is wild, because I can't remember what I had for breakfast this morning, but I can remember that.
I saw that in the theater, and that was one hell of a surprise ending.
Seriously, it got me. It definitely got me. I was not seeing that coming.
Let's see. Oh, you know what? I never did give the number, 603-250-6007, probably because we had calls right out of the gate, 603-250-6007. Well, it is the anniversary show. That's why we have these lovely balloons.
Oh, man. You're
these
an old
lovely
man.
Balloons. I am in my early 70s. That's true.
No, but you don't look a day over 80, though.
Pete's a few years older than me. He's in his mid-70s.
About 85.
But we're both, we're both a little bit older than Daryl Dion. But I think slightly younger than EZG, Eric Gagnon, so... let's see. So we should talk about Julian Assange has been arrested after spending nearly 7 years in an embassy in Ecuador. Fred says, did you just ask me to give you a...
what?
A harder one? Is this a Me Too moment? I don't think so, Fred.
Do you need me to step out of the room so you guys can have a conversation?
No. We've already gone far enough down that
Apparently
road with my...
you're leaving me behind. Is that what you're doing?
My ideas
today's
of...
Today's anniversary announcement is that you are flipping to the other team.
Maybe this is my coming out.
Doctor, I know it was sort of a doctor that's been waiting for that to happen.
Dr. Kevin, yes.
He probably has somebody in mind for you.
He probably does.
He does. He's trying to get rid of me, you know.
Oh, my goodness. Well, you know. Let's see. It says here, this is from Reuters. U.S. charges Assange after London arrest and 7 years in Ecuador embassy. British police dragged WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange out of Ecuador's embassy today after his 7-year asylum was revoked, paving the way for his extradition to the U.S. for one of the biggest leaks of classified information. Hours after the frail-looking Assange with white hair and a long beard was carried headfirst by at least 7 men out of the London asylum and into a waiting police van, U.S. officials announced he had been charged with conspiracy to commit computer intrusion. As he was being hauled out of the embassy in a dramatic scene shortly after 0900 GMT, Greenwich Mean Time, I believe that's what that means, the Australian-born Assange was heard shouting, quote, "This is unlawful. I'm not leaving." British Prime Minister Theresa May hailed the news in Parliament to cheers and cries of "hear, hear" from lawmakers. But in Washington, President Donald Trump, who in 2016 said, "I love WikiLeaks," after the website released emails about that U.S. authorities, rather, have said were hacked by Russia to harm the election, his election opponent, Hillary Clinton. He told reporters he had no opinion on the charges against Assange, saying, "I know nothing about WikiLeaks. It's not my thing." We have another call. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this?
Hi, it's Heidi from the lovely West Side.
Heidi from the West Side, how are you? Are you calling to wish me a happy anniversary?
Yes, I'm calling your anniversary show.
Wonderful.
Happy anniversary.
Thank you. Happy anniversary.
From the honorable.
The honorable Heidi right. Hamer, yes.
The honorable, yes.
Yes. Wishing a happy anniversary to myself, the ghost of John McCain, and virtual Dave Ridley. Thank you so much.
Yes.
Oh, and Jenny's here, too.
Do you see how he treats me?
Happy anniversary.
Heidi, do you hear this? Do you see what I'm putting up with?
I know.
Help me. It's not fair.
I'm not into pizza with pineapples on it, though.
Oh, yeah. Here I was sitting here doing honorable. Ay.
It's disgusting.
Goodness.
All right. Thank you, Heidi. All right. The honorable Heidi Hamer calling to wish us a happy anniversary.
Wish
Very nice.
Wish us. Did you notice that? Us. Not Just you.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Awesome. Oh, yeah.
Let's see. So should we play the...
I've just been hanging out
We'll play the audio after. I know I played it at the top of the show, but it's just fun to hear the audio of Trump with the WikiLeaks and his changing opinions, apparently. It says here, Assange gave a... This is from Reuters. Assange gave a thumbs up in handcuffs as he was taken from a police station to a London court where he pronounced himself not guilty of failing to surrender in 2012. District Judge Michael Snow called Assange a narcissist and convicted him of skipping bail. Sentencing will be at a later date. Police said they arrested Assange, age 47, after being invited into the embassy following the Ecuadorian government's withdrawal of asylum. He took refuge there in 2012 to avoid extradition to Sweden over a sexual assault investigation that was later dropped. Assange was carried out of the building located behind the luxury department store Harrods, carrying a copy of Gore Vidal's History of the National Security State, which he continued reading in court. Well, apparently, you can't separate him from a good book. In Washington, the U.S. Justice Department said Assange was charged with conspiring with former Army intelligence analyst Chelsea Manning to gain access to a government computer as part of a 2010 leak by WikiLeaks of hundreds of thousands of U.S. military reports about the wars in Afghanistan and Iraq and American diplomatic communications. The indictment was made secretly last year and unsealed on Thursday. He faces up to 5 years in prison if convicted, with legal experts saying more charges were possible. Ecuador suspended Julian Assange's citizenship and accused him and others at WikiLeaks of collaborating in attempts to destabilize the Andean nation's government. Is it Andean or Andean? After years of offering him shelter. Lawyers for Assange said he may risk torture and his life would be in danger if he were to be extradited to the United States. The arrest, after years holed up in a few cramped rooms at the embassy, represented one of the most sensational turns in a tumultuous life that has transformed the computer programmer into a fugitive wanted by the U.S. Theresa May said, quote, "The whole House will welcome the news this morning that the Metropolitan Police have arrested Julian Assange, arrested for breach of bail after nearly 7 years in the Ecuadorian embassy," unquote. Supporters of Assange and Ecuador, I'm sorry, said Ecuador had betrayed him at the behest of Washington, that the ending of his asylum was illegal, and that it marked a dark moment for press freedom. Barry Pollack, a lawyer for Assange, said in a statement reacting to the indictment, quote, "Journalists around the world should be deeply troubled by these unprecedented criminal charges," unquote. His admirers have hailed Assange as a hero for exposing what they describe as abuse of power by modern states and for championing free speech. His detractors have painted him as a dangerous figure complicit in Russian efforts to undermine the West and U.S. security. U.S. Senate Intelligence Committee Chairman Richard Burr, a Republican, said, quote, "Under the guise of transparency, Julian Assange and WikiLeaks have effectively acted as an arm of the Russian intelligence services for years. Hopefully he will now face justice," unquote. The Kremlin said it hoped Assange's rights would not be violated. WikiLeaks angered Washington by publishing hundreds of thousands of secret U.S. diplomatic cables that laid bare critical U.S. appraisals of world leaders. I remember that. That's why I'm chuckling, because some of that stuff was kind of funny. From Russian President Vladimir Putin to members of the Saudi royal family, Assange made international headlines in 2010 when WikiLeaks published a classified U.S. military video showing a 2007 attack by Apache helicopters in Baghdad that killed a dozen people, including two Reuters news staff.
They seem to gloss over. You know, the president of Ecuador gave an over 3-minute speech on why they removed the asylum.
Well, there is more to the article. I'm kind of scroll down here to look. But yeah, you were talking about that earlier.
Yeah, there's a lot of information in that. No matter where you are on the issue, if somebody, I'll tell you what's happening to this guy, in my opinion, it sounds like he's pretty much brought it on himself. I mean, there's over 3 minutes of the president going on and on and on of Ecuador about how they actually had to do a public letter over in the UK to basically shame him into cleaning up after his cat and taking a shower. You know, they've had a... they've asked, you know, they had to deal with him skateboarding through the embassy and asking him to, you know, stop ruining the floors, that he was disrespectful. And then to top it all off, he broke into their computers. Here's the people that are protecting you, and you break into their computers too? I mean, if he's one heck of a guest, that's for sure. I'm surprised, knowing that now, I'm really surprised that they hung in as long as they did.
Yeah, I mean, I can't help but wonder, and there's no evidence for this, at least yet, that I know of, but I can't help but wonder if all of that is true, or if there was some back-channel pressure from Washington, and they're sort of looking for a reason.
I don't know. You know? I mean, watching the Ecuadorian president give the speech, reading the words that he put out there and everything, I really do find credibility there. I mean, if you're going to make something up about a guy for a reason as to why you're going to evict him, is his cat pooping on the floor the reason you're going to come up with as the president of a nation? Or are you going to come up with something a little bit more that sounds a little bit better? I mean, the fact that he broke into their computers was enough, but they actually had to do a public letter, and the people of Britain had to hear all about it to get this guy to have some more hygiene. Good hygiene practices. I'm hearing a lot of sirens there, Maddie. I think they're coming to get you again.
That seems to happen once every show. And it's always a bunch of sirens. It always makes it sound like something terribly calamitous has happened. Fred posted a link to PolitiFact. I do love fact-checking in the Facebook live chat. So Jackie Speier today said that President Trump as a candidate mentioned WikiLeaks over 160 times in speeches in the last month of the campaign. Because remember, we played that, I played it at the top of the show, that bit of audio of Trump, yep. Trump saying today, I don't know anything about WikiLeaks. And then, of course, he mentioned it many times. So what PolitiFact is fact-checking here is, did Trump really mention WikiLeaks over 160 times in the last month of the election cycle? And they rate Jackie Speier's claim as mostly true. So here's what they say. Trump reveled in WikiLeaks disclosures against Democratic candidate Hillary Clinton during the closing argument of his presidential campaign. His CIA director, Mike Pompeo, revealed a different attitude in a tough April 13th speech, which addressed the anonymous hacking website. Pompeo said, quote, the group walks like a hostile intelligence service and talks like a hostile intelligence service, unquote. U.S. Representative Jackie Speier, Democrat of California, was one of many voices who noticed the administration's hardened view toward WikiLeaks. CNN anchor Wolf Blitzer interviewed Speier, a member of the House Intelligence Committee, on April 13th about Pompeo's characterization of WikiLeaks. April 13th. Well, I guess so it must have been. This is from. Wait a minute. I'm a little bit.
What are you reading?
April 13th.
How did you get into the future? Did you get like into a DeLorean or something and take
this,
off?
This article is actually from 2017. That's why.
Oh, you found an older one. Okay.
Well, Fred did.
Fred did.
But it addresses Jackie Speier's claim at the time, which is now relevant today. Okay, so. So Wolf Blitzer interviews Speier. How much did Trump, the candidate, love WikiLeaks in the last days of the campaign? She attempted to count the ways. And here's what she said, quote, if you recall, during the election cycle in the last month of the campaign, I believe that President Trump, as a candidate, hailed WikiLeaks as the new savior, had mentioned it over 160 times in speeches during that period of time. Really, that many times? We decided to check it out. WikiLeaks released tens of thousands of emails from the account of Hillary Clinton's campaign chairman, John Podesta, in October 2016, and released thousands of emails from Democratic National Committee staffers in July 2016. Speier's office said she was referring to a January 7 article by left-leaning website Think Progress for her statement. Here's how the article began. It said, quote, President-elect Trump says that information published by WikiLeaks, which the U.S. intelligence community says was hacked by Russia, had absolutely no effect on the outcome of the election. This was not the view of candidate Trump, who talked about WikiLeaks and the content of the emails it released at least 164 times in the last month of the campaign. The article went on to analyze Trump's speeches, media appearances, and debates to get a tally of 164 mentions between October 10th and November 8th. Wow. Just less than a month. That number includes 124 times Trump mentioned the group by name, with the rest being mentions of the emails released by WikiLeaks. We set out on our own review, looking through transcripts from Congressional Quarterly, by searching the words WikiLeaks and Trump and limiting results to the last month of the campaign. We found that Trump said the word WikiLeaks about 137 times in campaign rallies, interviews, speeches, tweets, and other social media and debates. Speer's figure of 160 seems possible, however, because he often referenced disclosures from WikiLeaks without using the group's name, and it's possible there were interviews or speeches where Trump brought up WikiLeaks that our search didn't return. And then there's more to this, but basically, I'm going to skip down here. So it says, our ruling, Speer said Trump as a candidate mentioned WikiLeaks over 160 times in speeches in the last 30 days of the campaign. Official counts may vary, but her larger point is clear. Trump brought up WikiLeaks a lot in the waning days of the campaign. He has stayed largely mum about the group since taking office, even as CIA Director Mike Pompeo said the group acts like a hostile intelligence office. So
now, I'd been listening to some of the reports earlier, and I don't know this for fact, but I remember mentioning it to you earlier that there's a claim that the United States and the UK and the Ecuadorian government basically all work together to coordinate the arresting him, and that there's an agreement, supposedly, now I believe this is a conjecture, of course, that there's an agreement to extradite him back to the United States for prosecution.
I have a long-standing theory, and I don't think I've ever said this to anyone who wound up agreeing with me, but here's what I think. Now, I'm skeptical that claim that was made is true. My theory is this. When it comes to Julian Assange, and I would apply this to Edward Snowden as well, I don't think our government wants any part of, particularly in Snowden, because Snowden's a United States citizen. Assange is from Australia. So I'm not sure exactly how that even works, whereas he's not from the U.S. But I would apply this to both Assange and Snowden, and I guess especially Snowden, since he is a U.S. citizen. We haven't heard Ed Snowden's name in a while, by the way. I forget now where he even is.
I thought he was, wait a minute, wasn't he in Russia?
He was for a long time, but I think he got moved somewhere else. I'm not sure where he is now. Fred will probably know that, but my theory is this. I don't believe that anybody, regardless of what is said publicly, I don't think anyone who's in a position to see through a prosecution of either of those guys in the United States actually wants one. And here's why. It is politically impossible waters to maneuver through. And here's why. Let's look at Snowden. Like I said, you can apply this to Assange as well, which is why I bring this up. But I think this is especially true with Snowden. When the news broke, when the name Edward Snowden first became, you know, a household name, with at least among people who pay attention to the news, he became immediately, in the eyes of many people, a traitor. But he also became, in the eyes of many other people, a hero. And one of the really interesting things about it, too, is it's one of the least partisan things I've ever seen in my life. There were both a lot of Democrats and a lot of Republicans who felt very strongly that this guy's a traitor. And also a lot of both Democrats and Republicans who felt very strongly this guy's a hero. It is a political nightmare to bring him. See, that's why I've always had a theory in the case, regardless of all these people, you know, whether it's the president, whether it's someone in Congress, whoever, who talks a big game about we need to get Edward Snowden back to the United States to prosecute him. My theory is they say that publicly, but privately and through back channels, they tell whoever has him, whether it's Russia or whoever, please keep him. Just keep him. We don't want him.
If that was the case, they probably would have paid Ecuador to keep him.
No.
Would Ecuador have allowed them to come in and take him?
I'm talking more about Snowden, so we'll get to Assange.
All right, that's true.
But so in the case of Snowden, because if we get him, if we ever get him, then what do we do with him? You can't execute him when half the country, again, it's you know, half of the people who pay attention to the news. You can't execute a guy who half the country thinks is a hero. It's impossible. Like, how do you maneuver through that? And then, of course, the other half wants to execute him because they think he's a traitor who committed treason. And I mean, with Assange, it gets more complicated. But we have a call. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this? Oh, that hurt. Some sort of beeping. Some sort of beeping and a fart.
Sounded like somebody died.
Oh, that might have been.
Well, is there a cardiac monitor kind of like going bye-bye?
I hope that wasn't EZG.
I don't think he has a home cardiac monitor, Matt. Really?
It kind of sounded like it could be that, but it also might have been a fart alarm.
I was expecting like a bomb to go off or something, but that wasn't the sound. So no. It sounded more like a cardiac monitor.
It could have been a fart alarm, because that would explain why the beeping.
Fart alarm? There's such a thing as a fart alarm?
There is, yeah. You can get them. That way you can kind of warn people around you if you have flatulence coming. Because if you notice, you heard the beeping, and then it ended with a fart. So I think it might have been a fart alarm.
I didn't know. Is that a thing that guys know about? Because this is new to me. Well, did not know there was an alarm for that.
Yeah, there is.
How does that work?
you basically attach it to your backside, and if
there a sensor or something that can tell it's coming?
Yes. I don't understand the technology in depth.
I think you seem to know an awful lot about it.
Well, I know. I mean, I did consider purchasing one online. And so if something is about to happen,
is that what you were looking up on Amazon?
That might upset some folks around you. Yeah, you know, a little alarm goes off, so then you know, and more importantly, they know that some flatulence is about to happen, which is nice. It's nice to know that.
I think it's better to just sneak and attack. You know, I mean, why warn?
Well, yeah, I mean that is more fun. But the thing is, if there's if it's silent, at least that's good. Like a silent bomb. If it's if it's noisy, then it's too easy to figure out where it came from. You know, you kind of just follow the sound, and it's like, oh, you did it. You know. Whereas if it's silent,
if you walk really
nobody
fast.
Knows. Yeah, that's true.
And, but, especially in a crowded room, yeah. You just leave the they get lost in the aroma,
right.
And they'll die of gas.
Just
poisoning.
Let them. Just let them wander.
Let them pass out from the gas.
Yeah. So I don't think.
How did we get on that topic? Oh my gosh.
So I don't think that
the
government wants any part of Snowden, and I don't think we want any part of Assange either, for the same reason.
But I don't believe, and we can see it already with Assange, because Ecuador insisted that there be an agreement that he cannot be extradited to any country where he would face torture or the potential of a death penalty. The United States is one of the only countries left that has a death penalty. That agreement is in writing. That agreement, they got to stick to. So I think you're half right. I think what's going to end up happening is the United States wants them in jail, wants to punish them because they don't want other people to think you can get away with it. But they're not going to charge him with something that can actually lead to a death penalty charge in order to keep peace with the world, keep peace with the nation. They'll try and do what they did with Chelsea Manning and put him away in jail forever and a day and hope that people will stop paying attention.
But see, here's the problem. That might fly with Assange if we didn't have President Donald John Trump. But you can't even forget about
the one that's in charge of prosecution.
Doesn't matter, though. Forget about the death penalty. Here's what I'm saying. If you can't, like, what does Trump do with this?
Nothing. Nothing. Everybody else. It's not going to be dealt with by him. He's the talking head in this situation. In this particular instance, I don't see him as any more than a talking head. The people in the Justice Department are going to be, in the judiciary, are going to be the one handling this issue. The president isn't going to do anything but toot hot air.
But nobody who is, like, you think William Barr wants to embarrass the president by trying to prosecute Julian Assange?
You're going to find a lot of things
you can't
closed-doored as hugely as possible because they can get away with it. It's a matter of national security.
Well, that's what I mean. That's why it won't happen because...
Oh, I think it's going to happen.
I'm sure Trump is going to have a conversation, closed door, with William Barr saying, dude, there's all this video of me praising WikiLeaks and Julian Assange. We can't prosecute this guy while I'm president. And then William Barr will say, yes, Mr. President.
Well, the U.S. certainly
I have to go back to redacting the Mueller
report
now, sir.
But I don't think the U.S. can afford to have him not brought back to the United States under the issue of us being a death penalty nation.
But I don't know how
it
we can even get him.
It can't be that reason.
Yeah, but he's Australian. He's not even an American. So I don't. I
Does
don't,
he face criminal charges in Australia?
I don't know. I don't know.
He's facing one.
I don't know how that works.
He's facing a 1 year charge right now in the UK. I mean, right now they've only the initial charge was getting him for failure to appear, but then he's got an underlying charge that carries approximately a 1 year sentence, from what I've understood. I don't know if he's facing any charges in Australia, but Australia and the United States, is he really worth straining relations? If it means that much, the American people, like it or not, like you said, it's almost like a 50-50 split. There's people out there that see hero and there's people out there that see traitor. And the people out there that see traitor want conviction, want justice. They're going to push as hard as they can to get him.
I don't think they will.
I think they will. I think they will. I think you're wrong on that one. I think you're wrong on that one for the simple fact that, like you said when you brought this up, in this case and in WikiLeaks, that these are the worst cases of espionage to happen in United States history since what? Revolutionary War times? I mean, really?
Oh, I don't know about that.
Has there really been anything worse in our timeline, in our lifetimes, with documents like this, with underlying with election manipulation, with what happened with the DNC? You know, I think that there's going to be we're getting into such, they've crossed so many lines, and they even broke into the Ecuadorian government's computers now too, that if the government lets it go, it's almost like a free pass. They got to push.
Yeah, they're going to let the UK do it. He's been extradited to the UK, right? So they're going to let the UK do it, and then nobody here has to worry about it.
I don't think the UK is going to keep him. I think that they've had him long enough, and they're going to be looking to either get him back to Australia or to the US. He is not going to end up staying.
The UK
hasn't
had him long enough. They're just getting him now because he's been extradited
there.
He's
been in the middle of London for almost 7 years. They've been dealing with it.
No, he's been in Ecuador.
No, he's been in the Ecuadorian embassy
what you mean.
In London.
Right, right.
When all of the public letters came out from the Ecuadorian government about his unsanitary habits, that was in the London papers.
No, I understand what you're saying, but the thing is, the London, they haven't had to deal with him while he's been in the Ecuadorian embassy.
Because
the embassy is considered, like, that's not London within the embassy. You know, the way embassies work, that's not...
I know.
That's not London.
But it's been in there. It's been in the middle of London. It's been in their media. Anything that goes on there is obviously going to end up in their media, just like it would if it was something that was happening here.
Right, but London hasn't had to deal with him, is what I'm saying. And I think, well, Fred just posted something in the Facebook live chat from the Australian.
Oh, cool.
It says Julian Assange arrested, found guilty. Already found guilty. So it says here, Australian WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange has been found guilty of absconding from bail relating to a British charge that began in 2010 and will be sentenced in Southwark Crown Court, where he faces up to 12 months in jail. Yeah, so he's going to be stuck there where he is in the UK.
Or there'll be something through the court systems where the sentence doesn't get carried out in Britain so they can get him out of their country. They want that man out of his out of their country. Bottom line, they don't want him.
Do you really think
the UK wants him?
Yeah, they want him in their prison.
They don't want him in their prison. They want him out of there.
No, I think they want him in their prison where
he's
locked up.
If they wanted that, they'd be doing more. They'd be going for more. They'd be trying to get more. They wouldn't be doing a simple...
Oh, they will. They'll add more charges. This is just the beginning, I'm sure.
But he literally was arrested, arraigned, and found guilty in less than 24 hours. You don't think they're trying to get him out?
No. They're trying to lock him up. They don't want him going anywhere.
They're going to hold on to him, but they're going to get rid of him. They're not going to want to keep him. The UK doesn't want him. The UK doesn't want any part of this. Who would? What nation would? They want to get rid of him. If they can send him back to Australia, they will. If they can send them to the United States, they will. They don't want the problem in their backyard. and they don't want to pay for it either.
It's not a problem if he's in a prison cell. Sure it is. I don't follow your logic. I don't understand why you don't think they want him in their prison.
You don't think he continues? I mean, his name is known. It's a household name. People know it around the globe. He is constantly in the media, in the limelight. Any prison he steps foot into is going to be under scrutiny, and is going to, any possibility of something going wrong is going to be an issue. I mean, he actually tried to sue the Ecuadorian government 3 times to prevent them from removing his protected status. Even though he was in protected status with them, he literally went and tried to use the legal system against them.
Yeah, I just...
I mean, the guys... Yeah, I don't know. I think maybe all these years of being stuck in that building have caught up on him. I don't know.
Oh, I'm sure. Yeah. I'm sure it broke him mentally. That's one of the things I was reading today. It says Assange attended the hastily arranged court hearing in Westminster Magistrates Court just hours after being dramatically arrested inside the Ecuadorian embassy in central London, where he had been living for nearly 7 years after President Lenin Moreno rescinded the Australian's political asylum. During some of the court proceedings, he read a Gore Vidal book titled History of the Security State. Judge Michael Snow said in findings Mr. Assange guilty. Said in finding Mr. Assange guilty of breaching bail conditions that his behavior was, quote, the behavior of a narcissist who cannot get beyond his own selfish interests, unquote. He will next appear at the Southwark Crown Court at a date to be fixed in relation to the sentencing on his bail conviction. He will be back in Westminster Magistrates Court on May 2nd for the start of the U.S. extradition hearing. Mr. Assange sent a message from his jail cell thanking people for all of their support, but insisting, I told you so. Assange's lawyer, Jen Robinson, said, quote, Julian Assange wants to thank everyone for their ongoing support, but he said, I told you so, unquote, reflecting the immediate extradition request filed by the U.S. within minutes of him being taken out of the Ecuador embassy on Thursday morning.
I think I'm right. Doesn't that sound like I'm right? You don't think so?
Well, there's an extradition request, yeah. But I'm just telling you my theory. My theory is they're going to find an excuse through back channels not to have him extradited to the U.S., it's a theory. I think the UK
is going to try and dump that hot potato as quick as they can. That's what I think.
Robinson sat on the steps of Westminster Court, where she struggled to make herself heard given the loud protesters shouting free, 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 that Assange's arrest set a dangerous precedent for media organizations. She said, quote, any journalist writing about the United States can be extradited for publishing truthful information about the United States, unquote. Ecuador President Lenin Moreno lashed out again at Assange, calling him a miserable hacker and a spoiled brat who was aggressive to the officials caring for him at the embassy. Moreno repeated allegations that Assange smeared his own fecal matter on the walls of the embassy building and said it was a sign of how the WikiLeaks founder viewed Ecuador. Well, if that's true, I certainly don't blame them for kicking him out. Jeez.
Exactly. I mean, I watched his speech. His entire speech, it was over 3 minutes, and it was genuine, very, very believable. And I mean, why would you say that? Why would you say somebody smeared that if it wasn't true? Don't you think they'd come up with something else?
Well, politicians say all kinds of things that aren't true. The president of a country
is going to come up with that one for an excuse for kicking somebody out of their embassy. Really? I think they'd be more creative.
We have a president who says crazy sounding things every day. You don't think the leader of a country can say crazy sounding things?
We have a zebra in the White House.
That they just make up out of...
You know what I mean by that, right? The medical zebra?
Yes.
It's an anomaly. It's
We have a president who just blurts out wind turbines cause cancer.
Oh, God.
With zero evidence. So
no,
I'm,
they don't.
I do believe that leaders of countries can sometimes come up with crazy sounding things and say them in public. Yes.
All right. But smearing poop on the wall, not picking up after your cat, not taking a shower, being abusive. I mean, it just, it's such a litany of things. And the fact that they had to take it to the public media in London to shame him and to clean it up is sickening. It's gross.
No, if it's true, I agree.
If they're protecting you and saving your life, you'd think you'd be like on your best behavior no matter what.
Fred says, hey, Trump doesn't mind journalists being cut up with a bone saw. I doubt he'll care about an Australian journalist going to jail.
He's right.
Well, yes. The only thing is, though, it's awkward.
Fred's right on that one.
It's awkward to have said journalists going to jail when there's all this video. I mean, I realize Trump supporters don't care. Whatever the new reality is that Trump has decreed, that's the new reality. I'm just saying, from my point of view, if we lived in a normal world where facts matter, it would be awkward to have this guy going to jail and the president being fine with it after the president throughout the campaign praised the guy,
yep,
or at least his organization. But we do live in a post-fact world where it doesn't matter. Today, Trump said, I don't know anything about WikiLeaks, so now Republicans everywhere are like, yeah, of course Trump didn't know anything about WikiLeaks.
Name the president who doesn't get to flip-flop on an issue and get a pass. I mean, it happens time and again. Whoever's in that office, flip-flop around, come up with an excuse. And then, yeah.
Well, Trump is an extreme case of that.
And
though,
he's the one that used to remember when he was running, he talked about flippers. Oh, the flipping of the flippers. And here he is doing exactly what he spends how much time talking about other people?
Oh, Fred made a good point. He says, that's because you understand shame. That's true. Trump doesn't understand shame, and neither do
apparently neither does Assange. Jeez.
Chris Rose joins us in the Facebook live chat. Hello, Chris. So we will we'll take a break. We're well past the top of the hour, but we've got I did find some Fred says, except he says all the time how smart he is.
You know what would be interesting?
He is a stable genius. Yes.
Could we get a count on Trump as far as how many times he uses I, me, and Trump? You know what I'm saying? I believe he's the I've never heard someone talk about themselves more than him.
Oh, yeah.
You know, when other presidents or other leaders, you know, get up there and talk about something, they say we or us or them, we're all working together to do this or we're all working to do that. Not Trump. Trump is everything me, I'm the greatest, I'm the best, I'm this, I'm that.
It's all about him.
I know.
All right.
So he gets to flippy flop.
That's right. So we'll take a break. And I did find some WikiLeaks related music today. So here's another song for you. This is called WikiLeaks Reveal.
Ah, check out all the deep state people. Ah, check out all the deep state people. The deep state is listening into all that we text or say. That's not okay. Then muddy the waters, make us believe that the Russians are solely to blame. We're pawns in their game. All the deep state people obsessed with their control. All the deep state and legions of their moles. Corporate media turns a blind eye, goes along to maintain market share. They haven't a care for lefties or righties, becoming consumed by a drive for a new civil war. Race is for all the deep state obsessed with their control. All the deep state people and legions of their moles. Ah, check out all the deep state people. Ah, check out all the deep state people. Caught in a dream, which is only a simulcast of what they want us to feel. Dish for real. All the deep state people. Dish
shadow of our soul. All the deep-state people crave complete control.
It seems one geek when it took the lead. What I'm spreading online is information. God nations are laughing at me, saying, get that dead rebel, combat his free speech. Each page that I'm giving you takes real lies and shows their false in face of real truth. While the state will keep sifting these, we're gonna wiki away those private eye stories.
Holy cow, we better stop, Grin. Have you seen his hot link? He's fresh from Afghanistan, from someone snatching transmissions of the soldiers that enlist. Also, the Russians will sell several missiles to Iran. Hot like Gaddafi's bodyguard line. Mugabe hate crimes, they plan to end his rule now soon. Crook, gambler, and drug cheat. Caboose's rap sheet. Informants told me so, I'll bust you. Wanna sneak a peek at Mozambique, or seek a sheik, a scene, a leak. We got gorilla news from underneath the table. Serbia's slow to join the show with Kosovo. They still say no, so screw an anchor, cause we're leaking news with cables. Security talks with the head of Sunnis in Baghdad. Pakistan bomb reports Islamabad. Canada's Haitian governor general. Can't wait for scandal, BP in the oil spill. A real intensity with Terran Eye in Tel Aviv. People are listening from all over the world.
It seems one geek when it took the lead. Nuclear arms in the air for Prince Sarkozy. Blackwater's a rocky spree. Plus criminal drug lords Mexico seized an El Salvadorian in the room. The good, the bad, and the ugly of that Brunez dude. Paraguay traffic's overseas. Sources get hacked each day, I'll broadcast their story.
We're used to exposing corrupt or abusive organizations. People will try and distract from the significance of the evidence against them by trying to shoot the messenger.
China and cyber victims, they never can click Google links too wicked. Documents, files, if you find some, send them my way, son. Don't think the smoking gun is this one. Terrorism, Jordan stuck, they landlocked. Violence in Bangkok, Africa's refugees are ratified. Phobos, Zimbabwe, diamonds got killed. Policeman's vaults filled, those poor guys tend to all be camera shy. Completed fleet of secret subs, the war was from Georgie Dobbs in every spine. You're a guy and we are hacking. A lot of hits, Kabul to Istanbul, as well as all over the whole Japanese trade in that crazy Ching Kim Jong Il. You hear the Saudis throw their asses right off with Iran. Palestine, soccer riots in Amman. To be by Iraq's unicameral plans to disband Argentine Falkland oil drills. From every embassy we share online all their leaks. So many whistleblowers dishing out dirt.
It seems two sweets made a crook of me. Cops are gummy inside, they sway the jury. I'm jailed for an act or two of consensual consummation with no condom screwed. Leaked fables were in the news. The reason that I shot to fame became a rare clue. Slucked away a category B. Two stitchy old pictures made up some story. Should never have chased and tail from those slurries. It'll still be 2 days till my bail in Surrey. Can't wait to leak this tale in a hurry.
We will continue to expose abuses by this administration and others.
Do you still love WikiLeaks?
I know nothing about WikiLeaks. It's not my thing. And I know there is something having to do with Julian Assange. I've been seeing what's happened with Assange, and that will be a determination, I would imagine, mostly by the Attorney General, who's doing an excellent job. So he'll be making a determination. I know nothing really about him. It's not my deal in life.
What would you like to see happen? What punishment?
I don't really have any opinion. I know the Attorney General will be involved in that, and he'll make a decision. Okay?
WikiLeaks! WikiLeaks, I love WikiLeaks. These WikiLeaks, as confirmed just today by WikiLeaks.
It's been amazing what's coming out on WikiLeaks. They want to distract us from WikiLeaks.
The wonder of WikiLeaks. Boy, that WikiLeaks has done a job on her, hasn't it? We've learned so much from WikiLeaks. Oh, we love WikiLeaks. Boy, they have really WikiLeaks. I mean, this WikiLeaks is fascinating. The WikiLeaks revelations. This WikiLeaks is like a treasure trove.
WikiLeaks, right?
WikiLeaks.
And you know, as I was getting off the plane, they were just announcing new WikiLeaks, and I wanted to stay there, but I didn't want to keep you waiting. I love reading those WikiLeaks.
WikiLeaks. It just came out on WikiLeaks. We'll be right back.
doesn't really love WikiLeaks. He's just kidding around. Hey, everybody, welcome back. It's hour number two of Matt Connerton Unleashed in the Afternoon, well into hour number two here on WMNH 95.3 FM. And by the way, just to remind you, it is the 2-year anniversary of being here on WMNH. And there we go. That deserves an air horn. And if you're watching on Facebook or on Comcast 97, these lovely balloons, those might look familiar to you. Anyway, welcome, everybody. 603-250-6007 is the number to call. 603-250-6007. We've been talking about WikiLeaks and Julian Assange, but there's some other breaking news. It appears that, the Russia probe, the Mueller investigation, whatever term you want to use, someone not associated with Trump at all appears to have gotten swept up in it. It's, according to Politico, grand jury indicts former Obama White House counsel Gregory Craig. Some breaking news today, but we do have a call. Let's grab this. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this?
This is Father Bruno Sarducci. Hello, Matt.
Oh, my goodness. Father Bruno Sarducci, how are you, sir?
Yeah, I watch you all the time.
All the way from the Vatican.
I get on my Facebook page.
Oh, very nice.
I'm your friend.
Yes, yes. Thank you for friending me on Facebook, Father. It's wonderful.
Yeah, but, you know, I love WikiLeaks. I love it.
You love WikiLeaks.
I love WikiLeaks.
Now, what is it that you love about it, Father Bruno?
I love information.
Yes.
A lot of information.
Yes.
And WikiLeaks has a lot, lots of information. And I love it. I don't know why, but I know, Donald Trump, he like it too.
Oh, yes. Well, today he claimed that he doesn't know anything about WikiLeaks.
He's just playing it closer to the chest.
Yes, yes.
You know, even the Pope, he love a WikiLeaks.
Really?
You know, but they never get any Vatican information. You know, it's impossible.
Right. Of course. Yes.
Well, yeah. We don't use a computer. You know? We're not getting into that game. We know how that ends.
Right. No, I understand,
no,
Father.
Email. No text, no nothing. You know, we write it down, then we burned it up.
That's probably wise for a variety of reasons. But let me ask you this, Father. So if Julian Assange could somehow manage to get there, would you offer him asylum at the Vatican?
Yeah, we don't get into the asylum thing too much. You know, we've had a few legal problems here in the Vatican. You know, we're trying to keep our nose clean now because, it costs a lot of money to shut people down. You know, kind of like Donald Trump. You know, I mean, you gotta pay people off. You know, they call it a lawsuit, but you know what it is. It's a payoff.
Right. Yes. Yes.
Yeah, but but the Pope, he's behind Donald Trump 110%.
Oh, that surprises me.
He's just like Donald. He's just like him.
Really?
Except he's not married, you know, to anybody.
Right, right.
Not married to Melania, you know, beautiful woman, you know.
Right.
I get it. I get Donald Trump totally, 100%. I get him. And he love a WikiLeaks, too.
Right. I was kind of under the...
I hope they don't use no computer, because they're going to get it. You know?
I was kind of under the impression, though, that the Pope didn't necessarily agree with President Trump on things like immigration and a border wall and things like that.
Yeah, we got to make it look good. You know, we got a lot of parishioners in South America.
Yes.
You know, we got to make it sound good.
Right. No, that makes sense.
Yeah,
that makes sense.
You know, we don't want to lose them. We got a lot of... collection plates, you know, going through the South American cathedrals. You know, it's a business decision.
Right. Well, that makes complete sense, Father. I can understand that entirely. You have a lot of parishioners down there.
But the WikiLeaks, it doesn't get any better than that. You know, we like a little gossip here, too. You know, we're not going to send any emails. I guarantee you that.
Yes, yes.
I hear Donald Trump. He doesn't use email. You know, he's not going to get involved with that. He's too smart for that.
Yes.
But, you know, like our Pope is just like Trump. He's just like
really,
him.
Really.
I mean, he even acts like him. He puts on a different act. You know, he gets on the, you know, he waves his arms. He's on the patio. You know, waving at people. But you know, inside, he's just like a Trump.
Oh my goodness.
And just like a Trump, He's infallible.
Infallible, yes, absolutely.
He's infallible.
Absolutely.
You know. Trump don't make no mistake, and
right.
And the Pope, he don't make no mistake.
I can kind of picture the Pope and like taking off the giant Pope hat there, putting on a make America great again hat. I can picture that.
Well, no, see, we can't do that. You know?
Well, I mean,
we can't do that.
But,
you know, Matt, you know, I call you so many times. You know, I watch your show.
Yes.
But you know, and I love you, Matt. I love the way you do your show. But that woman you had on your show, she arguing with you.
I know, right?
You know, that was bad.
Now that's
I couldn't understand it. You need to shut her down.
Oh my goodness!
You know, I had a nun like that doing my show with me. You know, she wouldn't shut up. You know, she contradicting me. You know, making you crazy talk. You know,
right?
She was a nice Catholic girl. You know, but you know, I had to get rid of her. You know.
Oh my goodness!
So,
wow.
You know, she went kicking and screaming, but you know, we had the excommunicator. I think she's a Lutheran now.
Oh, my goodness, she's a Lutheran. Well,
not as good as a Catholic. You know, Luther, he had a few problems with the church.
Well, yes.
But we had crushed him, you know.
That's true. Yeah. I like girls and nuns' habits. How about you, Father? Or you're not allowed to do that, I guess.
Well, you know, we see them. You know,
yes.
They look fine. You know, it's
yes.
A little bit different here. The nun costume is a little bit different.
Yes, of course.
Even my costume. It's a little bit different than what you see in the States.
Oh, is it?
I've been to the States. It's a nicer place.
Yes, yes, absolutely. Well, how could it not be?
But, you know, Donald Trump, you know, I'm very happy for him. The Pope and I, we talk about it all the time. Donald Trump completely exonerated. He's smooth sailing from here on in to 2024.
You should have him as a guest on your show. Don't you do a show there from the Vatican?
Yeah, of course we do a show. You know?
Oh, yeah.
You know, we have our own spectrum. It's a little bit higher than yours. You got to have a special permission.
Wow.
The Vatican spectrum, a special Catholic spectrum.
It's like a shortwave or something, right? It's like
I'm this is what I don't understand. You know, I got a Facebook Live page too. You never come on. You never call me. Well, what is that? I call you. You never call me. What is that?
Well, you know, I don't know quite how to reach you, Father. You know, I've asked for guidance, you know, but my prayers have not been answered, so I'm not sure how to get in touch with you.
Yeah, okay. You know, you're making some excuses, but you're making me feel the bad. You know, I'm feeling the bad.
Oh, I'm sorry,
because
Father.
You never call me.
Oh.
You never watch my show. And, you know, it's a one-way relationship. I can see that.
There's a reason. There is a reason, Father, and I'm embarrassed to say this, but I am myself very much a lapsed Catholic. I've not been to church in a very long time, and I feel a little self-conscious about it.
As you should, sir.
Mm.
You should feel self-conscious.
I do.
You should come back to the church because, you know, the church, it's a beautiful. You know, kind of like the Vatican. You ever been to the Vatican?
I don't know if I'd be allowed either, Father, and that's another thing I'm a bit self-conscious about.
We welcome everybody into the Vatican. You know, we got guards there. They don't wear uniform, nothing. You know, people don't know who they are. We got plenty of guards if anything, you know, goes wrong.
But
Vatican's a great place, and you should come, and you should watch my radio. You should listen to my radio show or watch it on my Facebook page. But listen, I'm telling you about something. We're doing something entirely different now.
Oh.
Yeah, we're doing the Vatican. We're getting into the movie business.
You are?
Ooh. Oh, yeah. We're getting into the movie business.
Vatican Films.
If you got the right subject matter, and we're doing a movie, we're doing Exodus. We're going to remake it.
You are? That's exciting.
Yeah, the Catholics are going to take over Jerusalem.
Oh my goodness. Wow. Okay.
Yeah. And I'm going to be in the movie.
You are. You're a thespian.
You know, the Pope has already told me I get a good role in the movie.
Oh. Are you going to have a big part? Are you the starring role? Are you like a leading man?
It's going to be a pretty big part because I get to sing the Exodus song. You know that?
No, I don't know that song, actually. The Exodus song?
Oh, yeah. I'm going to sing a little bit of it to you, you know, in a few minutes. But I just want to tell you, I'm a singer. You know, in addition to being an important radio host for the Vatican... I'm also a singer, and I do editorials, but mostly I like to sing, and I was a choir boy.
You were?
Yeah.
Wow.
Oh, I was a choir boy, yeah. Ooh. A soloist, yeah.
Wow.
But, you know, there was no priest. They never touch me, you know.
Well, that's good.
this is, you know, you hear that scandal, but it's just, It's a made-up story.
It's all overblown, I'm sure. Yes.
Yeah, it's overblown. It never happened. It's a made-up story.
Right, right, yes.
Fake.
Fake news?
It's a fake story, and it never happened, you know, and because the Catholics, they're good people, you know?
Yes.
We got some character. We got some morality.
Yes, yes.
You know.
Wow, that's...
But in the United States, who knows what happens here, but no father ever touched me. You know what I'm saying?
Right, right.
Never touched me in a private place. Never happened.
Here, that's they call that fake news here in America.
Fake news, yeah. It wasn't even news, you know, but I mean, people, they're always going to try to get some money, you know?
Mm-hmm. That's right, yes.
They're going to try to get a money,
mm-hmm.
and they're going to use a made-up story, you know, mm-hmm. a hoax.
Right.
Make us look bad.
Sure, sure.
But we're not. We're good. You know,
right.
Like Donald Trump. We're good people.
Absolutely.
And we're just trying to, you know, spread the good news. You know what I'm saying?
I understand, yes, yes. Very exciting. Very exciting.
Okay, now listen. I want you to be quiet during this.
Yes.
Because I'm gonna give you a little bit of my song.
Oh, lovely.
In Exodus.
Lovely. Okay.
And we got the priests here. We got a little band. We got the Vatican band here.
You have a band with you, a Vatican band.
We got the Vatican band.
Are they all priests as well?
You got to be quiet though.
Oh, okay.
You got to respect me.
Oh, of course.
I like that girl you had on your show. She, you know, shouldn't respect you. So you got to shut her down. You know, excommunicate her.
Well,
you know, we excommunicated our woman. You know, the nun, but she lived. You know, in the old days, we would have cut her head off.
Well, she's not. She
burned her at the stake. But you know, we're more civilized now.
Yeah. Well, Jenny isn't. Jenny isn't Catholic, so you know how that is.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So. Let me give you a little taste, huh?
Yes.
You can dip your beak into this. Hit it, boys.
Ooh.
I hope you're hearing this, Matt.
I can, yes.
They're sounding good.
It's fantastic. Ooh.
This land is mine. God gave this land to me. This brave and ancient land to me. And when the morning sun reveals her hills and plains, then I see a land where the children can run free. Okay, stop it, guys.
Ooh.
So what do you think?
Father Bruno Sarducci, that was beautiful. It brought a tear to my eye. Or that might just be my allergies and my eyes are watering. I'm not sure, but that was beautiful.
Yeah. You know, I'm going to give it my best. You know, I'm not perfect now. It's been a long time since I've been the choir boy. But, you know, I'm gonna get into it. I'm going to be a star. You know, maybe I even get an Academy Award or something, you know?
Oh, I can see that. I can definitely see that.
Yeah. And listen, you got to clean up your show. You know, the last time I come on, it was the Peter White guy there, you know.
Oh.
The guy's got no charisma.
Oh, my goodness.
Now, you got to keep him off. And the woman that you were with, you got to get rid of her. And you got to get somebody that's going to sit there and agree with you. You know, you don't need a big argument about Julian Assange, who is my personal hero, I got to tell you.
Yes, yes.
Because this guy's got the informations, and he's giving it to the people. That's only right.
Well, I do have the ghost of John McCain with me as my official co-host, and he's very agreeable.
I'm John McCain.
Yeah. He didn't make it to heaven, though. I got to tell you, he didn't make it.
Oh, that's too bad. Is he in purgatory?
Yeah,
where is he now?
You know, he made a few mistakes.
Oh, you know? Right. Is it
starting
because...
with getting captured? You know.
Well, that's true. That disqualifies him from being a warrior. Plus, there was that whole savings and loan thing in the '80s.
And he was singing like a bird, you know, and when he's in that prison, you know, he's ratting out the United States.
Oh,
it's
my
not
goodness.
Good.
Oh, no. Well,
absolutely.
Yeah, you know, we take care of that. You're not going to see that in the Vatican.
No, that's probably why he continues to haunt me. He's stuck here.
Hey, listen, you know, I got to go now because I got to meet my cousin. My cousin is... We're going to be rehearsing, you know, he's a piano player.
Oh.
And I'm going to rehearse in some of this song so I get it down, you know, perfect. And his name is Giuseppe Sarducci. He's a brother.
Giuseppe?
Not a priest. Is it a very talented guy, you know.
Giuseppe or Giuseppe? How do you say that?
Giuseppe.
Giuseppe. Okay.
Giuseppe. You know, you don't have to say it right. You're an American. We don't expect too much.
That's that's probably
listen,
better.
You know, it's been good talking to you, and tell you what.
Yes.
Tell you what, Matt.
Yes. Yes.
Next time, you call me, okay?
All right, I'll call you next time, Father.
I don't want to feel bad. Next time you call me, be nice, okay?
I will always be nice. You're a man of the cloth. I could never be anything but nice to you, Father.
Okay. Well, thank you very much. Bye-bye.
All right, Father. Bye-bye. All right. Well, that was what a nice surprise to hear from Father Bruno Sarducci. I believe he's the nephew of Father Guido Sarducci. And what a wonderful song he sang. And that deserves an air horn, I think. I think that even Virtual Dave Ridley enjoyed that.
Yeah.
There you go. And you know how hard he is to he's very difficult to please Virtual Dave Ridley.
Okay, whatever.
I think Virtual Dave Ridley is the actual Dave Ridley is a musician. I don't know if Virtual Dave is, but that was lovely. Thank you so much, Father Bruno Sarducci, calling all the way from the Vatican in Rome. That has to be very pricey. Hello to Stefan Philbrook, who joins us in the Facebook live chat. So finishing up with this. So, again, this is from Politico. Some breaking news today. The grand jury has indicted a former Obama White House councilman, or I shouldn't say councilman. That makes him sound like he sat on the city council, a lawyer, White House counsel, Gregory Craig. So it says here. This is breaking news this afternoon. Gregory Craig, the former Obama White House counsel, was charged by a federal grand jury today with making false statements and concealing material information about his work in private practice lobbying on behalf of the Ukrainian government. So it's not just Michael Flynn and Paul Manafort apparently mixing it up with the Ukrainians. Member of the Obama administration. The two-count indictment filed in U.S. District Court in Washington, D.C., says that Craig, age 74, purposefully and repeatedly misled federal investigators about his need to register as a foreign lobbyist, including in 2017 when he when interviewed by prosecutors for special counsel Robert Mueller. And that's part of what's so interesting about this story, like I was saying earlier, is it's someone completely separate from Trump, someone from, the other team, so to speak, getting swept up in this Mueller probe. I didn't see this one coming. This is a little bit of a curveball. It says, Craig, who served under President Barack Obama during his first year in office in 2009, is the first Democrat to face criminal charges in a case with ties to the Mueller investigation into Russian interference in the 2016 election. While the special counsel's investigation officially wrapped up last month, the Justice Department recently said it was placing new emphasis on examining foreign lobbying activities that became a featured part of Mueller's efforts. Maybe he'll try to use the Michael Flynn excuse. Well, you didn't remind me that it wasn't okay to lie. So what are you going to do, right? Let's see. At issue for Craig is work he did starting in 2012 after his White House stint at the Skadden, Arps, Slate, Meagher & Flynn law firm Meagher & Flom, not Flynn. You know where I got Flynn. Michael Flynn's name was kicking around in my mind. Skadden, Arps, Slate, Meagher, and Flom law firm preparing a report concerning Ukrainian President Viktor I'm never sure how to say this name. Yanukovych. Oh, I think I got it. I think it is Yanukovych. Viktor Yanukovych's jailing of one of his political opponents, former Prime Minister Yulia Tymoshenko, something like that. Why can't these people have simple American names like the rest of us? My goodness. Let's see. The report was meant to be used by President Donald Trump's former campaign manager, Paul Manafort, who had been lobbying for Yanukovych at the time to defend the former president. Craig's work came under renewed scrutiny by Mueller's team as it prosecuted its case against Manafort, who hired Skadden Arps in 2012. The firm, which Craig retired from last year, pleaded guilty in January to misleading the Justice Department about its work with Manafort. Excuse me. And paid a $4.7 million settlement. A Dutch lawyer at the firm, Alex van der Zwan, Those names are fine. I don't mind Dutch names, even though they're not like good, easy American names like Smith or Jones or Papadopoulos. But they're fun to say. Alex van der Zwaan pleaded guilty last year to lying to the FBI and spent nearly a month in prison before being deported to the Netherlands. According to the 22-page indictment, Craig was aware of federal requirements to register as a foreign lobbyist, but didn't want to do it, quote, at least in part because he believed doing so could prevent him or others at his law firm from taking positions in the federal government in the future, unquote. So, you know, just to be clear about this, this isn't a case of, you know, he forgot, because I think when, you know, when Michael Flynn got caught up in this, you know, failure to register as a lobbyist working for Ukraine and whatnot, part of the excuse that some who are sympathetic to him were making was, well, you know, it's easy. It's an easy thing to forget. You know, you get you have to navigate through the maze of all this bureaucracy and all these rules and laws. And, you know, you're going to forget things, right? Things are going to fall by the wayside. But, you know, and then, of course, Flynn lied to the FBI. And then it was, well, you know, no one reminded him. You can't lie to the FBI. So this sounds like what this guy did, this guy Gregory Craig. I mean, he did this with intent. He had a specific purpose into why he did this. He was, you know, deliberately being dishonest. There's no, clearly, if this is true, you know, there's no way to excuse this or kind of shrug it off or rationalize it. He did it with a specific intent to deceive for a specific reason. So the indictment says, quote, these disclosures, as well as the fact of registration itself, would have undermined the report and Craig's perceived independence, unquote. Anticipating the indictment, Craig's attorneys on Wednesday night issued a preemptive statement saying their client's work had been, quote, thoroughly investigated by federal prosecutors in the Southern District of New York, who said they declined to press charges. The lawyers, William W. Whoops, this just kind of skipped down on me. Sorry about that. The page kind of refreshed itself. Okay, the lawyers William W. Taylor III and William J. Murphy said the Justice Department's National Security Division then asked for Craig's case to be taken up by the U.S. Attorney's Office in Washington. Quote, Mr. Craig is not guilty of any charge, and the government's stubborn insistence on prosecuting Mr. Craig is a misguided abuse of prosecutorial discretion, unquote, the attorney said in a statement on Thursday afternoon. Taylor and Murphy responded to the indictment, and that's, you know, there's just a lot of stuff there about, you know, why he's not really guilty, et cetera, et cetera. But just to kind of skip down to the end of this, it says Craig's post-Obama White House career included a brief stint as defense counsel representing former Senator John Edwards, remember him, in his case involving nearly $1 million in payments to his backers made to support a pregnant mistress during the 2009 presidential campaign, while his wife was dying of cancer, by the way, charming fellow, that John Edwards. A jury in 2012 deadlocked on five felony counts in the Edwards case and voted to acquit him on one charge before the Justice Department dropped the case outright in 2012. So very, very exciting. And we are joined in the studio by Ben Dion. And Ben, I almost didn't recognize you without your dad. Oh, whoops. I brought the wrong mic up. There we go. Where is your father?
Do you think he's using the facilities?
Oh, he usually comes in with you. I was afraid something had happened. Because Peter White on the morning show, he keeps losing people.
I know.
Len hasn't been there for a while. Len Lorenz. Eric Gagnon is apparently ill.
I heard about that
one. Won't
be
there tomorrow.
Yeah.
And you know, I was speculating earlier that, you know, at the rate he's going, he might get a visit. He's going to be very lonely. He might get a visit from the ghost of John McCain. Who knows, you know?
I'm John McCain.
See?
I know.
Or maybe even virtual Dave Ridley.
Yeah.
You know, because I have these entities that have descended upon my show. And it's like I was telling Jenny earlier, like, I have no control over it. Like, the ghost of John McCain just haunts the studio
right
between 4 and 6. And virtual Dave Ridley has taken over the computer like HAL in 2001.
Right. Didn't he shut off the computer the other day, reboot it for you?
He did.
I heard about that, yeah.
Yeah, because I don't know why. I don't know why he does. He was frustrated about something.
He doesn't sound like Matt.
Yeah, he gets mouthy, and it's very...
You're gonna think it's an April Fool's joke what I'm actually calling about. You're not gonna believe it, and I didn't believe it for a while. I had to research.
Yeah, see, and then he goes off on these wild tangents that don't have anything to do with anything. But did you notice the balloons? Today is the 2-year anniversary of Matt Connerton Unleashed here at WMNH 95.3 FM. And someone thoughtfully left some blue balloons.
Wow.
Isn't that awesome? Nice?
Yeah. That's very nice.
Yes. So happy anniversary to me and of course, the ghost of John McCain and virtual Dave Ridley. And we have a call. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this?
EZG again.
EZG. How are you, sir? Oh, Daryl Dion.
I'm funny to tell you, Ben.
Daryl Dion is here.
I've been working at the Creamland with a lot of the... not a lot, but a couple of the kids, not really kids, but younger than me, obviously.
Uh-huh.
There's one high school kid that works there.
Yes.
My new favorite question. A lot of them go to Memorial, so I said, well, hey, do you know young Ben Dion, the teacher?
Oh.
Oh, yeah, I know that guy.
Yeah.
For teacher yet?
Who, Eric?
No.
Eric,
but
who's the...
have had you for
who are the
teacher,
kids that you have there?
Have not, but most of those kids... Not really kids, but they're older now, about 20-something. I know you've been working there for a couple of years, right, Ben?
Yeah, this is my it's my fifth year over there at Memorial.
Who are the people that knew me? I think he's just a sophomore, so he hasn't had you yet, but he knows who you are, so it's one of my new favorite questions to ask. Do you know this guy, and how do you know Ben Dion? So, well, he has the show on Thursday nights. Oh, yeah, I've heard about that show.
Heard about that show.
It means he doesn't listen.
Right,
yeah,
right.
I'm on a little show called Pee the White Morning Show. Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, I never heard of that show.
Yeah. Well.
It was funny the other day when the milkman left on Monday. I had to say something. My boss, Nicole, the lady owns that place, and her sister, Natalie, Nicole said, wow, is that radio guy? I mean, that guy. He delivers the milk. He has a perfect voice for the radio. So I had to say something, you know?
Well, of course.
Couldn't resist.
The running gag on the Peter White Morning Show is, do they know the EZGs are working at Creamland?
Right, yes.
So I told her I was working there. I've been talking you guys up for a couple of weeks now. She goes, wow, thanks. Free advertising.
Well, I know that Daryl Dion here is very excited to hear from you because, Daryl, you sounded – I was listening to the morning show. You sounded genuinely concerned for the health and well-being of EZG.
I definitely was. I had returned from a bathroom trip, and he was definitely under the weather.
But I'm thinking it's cellulitis. I just called up around 4 o'clock and asked for the results. He said the results are in, but the nurse has to read them.
He doesn't really care what
so
I got to say.
I'll either hear later tonight or I'll hear some report.
Okay, whatever.
Morning. I'm thinking of cellulitis because both my feet are swelled, my legs are swelled.
How about the head?
Okay,
is that
okay,
a head
no, swell? Right, enough of that.
Oh, sorry.
Well,
what
like I told Matt earlier, I'll be home resting tomorrow. So
oh, I may. I see. Yes, I get it. All right, fine. Yes.
So you're not coming on the show tomorrow?
No, I already made
not
that
really.
Announcement earlier, yeah. The
okay.
doctor wants me to rest the next 4 days.
No one seems to be very excited. No, no idea.
So anyways, I'll be listening to the full report tonight.
It's not. It's some Quaalude guy who's talking about awful
that,
music.
Maybe, so I'll be listening to
your
report tonight.
No,
so,
no, it's not working. It's not working.
And,
I just see Matt.
Hey,
I have something for you if you want it. Can you hang on for a sec?
Oh, I think Eric
hung
up.
Thanks, Matt.
Virtual Dave Ridley. I just want to apologize to EZG and everyone on behalf of Virtual Dave Ridley, who was very rude just now, just talking over Eric like that. Because Eric, of course, as we all know, would never talk over anybody.
Never.
No, no never.
Know? Especially not when someone like yourself, Daryl Dion, would be expressing great concern for Eric Gagnon. He would be so appreciative of that he would never... interrupt you and talk over you, and yet here's Virtual Dave Ridley being very rude to Eric. I just can't even believe it.
I am no longer concerned.
Oh, good.
He's just fine.
Yes,
he seems pretty normal.
Yeah.
Or seems pretty much like seems like himself.
Now you don't want to use the word normal.
No, he seems like himself.
All right, we got time for one more quick call. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this?
Good morning. May I please speak to the lovely and talented Mr. Carnation?
That is me. That is one of the many variations of my name. Yes.
how are you?
Or what did EZG call me? Mike Connerin, I think. But how are you, Brooklyn Mike?
I'm fine, thank you. I'm just calling to say congratulations, Matt, on 2 years.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
That deserves an air
horn. Prediction.
That deserves an air horn.
My prediction is you will make it to 20 years on the radio.
20 years? Oh, my goodness.
Wow.
That's my prediction.
That's your prediction. Well, we'll see what happens.
We'll see if we can make that happen.
Yes, yes.
You could do it, Matt. I didn't know if the ECG soliloquy was over yet.
just doesn't end. I mean, it just keeps on keeping on.
Oh, God.
I know. Well, can you believe how rude virtual Dave Ridley was for just talking over him like that? So I'm embarrassed.
Well, yeah. Well, that only virtual Dave would do that. He would never do it if he was live. You know what I'm saying? That's the beauty of the virtualness.
Right. Well, that's true. Yeah, that's absolutely true. All right.
All right, guys. I'm going to let you go. I know it's getting late. Daryl, Ben, have a great night. Have a great show.
Thanks, Brooklyn Mike.
Thank you.
All right, Brooklyn Mike. Thank you for the call, my friend.
Okay, fellas. See ya.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye.
All right, and we'll start to wrap up in a moment because the Weekly Die-On is coming up next, but what do you guys have planned?
This week we're doing a little bit different of a format. We're trying out for the second time the new format, which is more discussion-based.
Okay.
It's a new segment I like to call The Collective Perspective.
Ooh, I like that because it rhymes. You're like a rapper or something.
I can't take credit for that.
Oh.
My wife came up with the name.
Oh, very nice.
Yeah, I was trying
Ashley
to think.
Did that?
Yeah.
Excellent.
I was trying to come up with a catchy segment name for the discussion-based show, and I was throwing around some different ideas, and I wanted perspective in it. And she's like, what about the collective perspective? It's a collective group of you that will talk, and that should be it. So we're going to be talking about the commuter rail and possibility of it coming up here to New Hampshire.
Oh, very nice. Very nice. Yeah. All right.
Sadly, the probably unlikely. It's going to be tough.
Yeah.
It's going to take a lot of hard work to get it done, and it's going to take people that are really, really want it to happen for it to happen.
Right.
Don't give too much away over
true.
There,
Dan. No, I won't.
Oh. Yeah. All right. And Bill Muckler in the Facebook live chat says, congratulations, Matt. Wishing you many more. Thank you, Bill. Stefan Philbrook says, congrats on 2 years. I just really want you to blow the air horn. All right. One more for the anniversary. By the way, guys, I can leave that here if you want to use it during your show. I'll leave the air horn.
Yeah.
You know, you'll have to clean it or something probably, but feel free to use it. Absolutely. All right, so we're gonna go. Stick around. Oh, Tony Petrillo says congratulations. Love the show, Tony. Thank you so much. All right, a lot of love in the Facebook live chat, and I do appreciate that. Thank you, Jenny, for joining me earlier. Thank you, Father Bruno Sarducci, for calling in. That's always fun. And anybody I might have forgotten, and Easy G Eric Agnon, who I think called three times today, keeping us abreast of his ailments. And thank you, Daryl, for looking out for him.
Thanks, Matt. Congrats on 2 years.
Yes, thank you so much. All right, everybody. And if you miss any part of today's show, it'll be up in just a little bit at WMNHradio.org. I'm going to get out of here. I'll talk at you all tomorrow. And the Weekly Die-On is next. Stick around.
Daddy came to this country. He escaped from Iraq, and he came with nothing but a dream of the American flag. He wanted my mother, my sister, our carpet and me to grow up and live happy in the land of the free. Now this nation that I love is under terror attack. Ain't another sucker.